This is the area, or a bit of the area, in southern England known as the South Downs. Charlotte Turner Smith spent the first few years of her life here, as did the poet Shelley.
This house, Bull Beating, was Turner Smith's childhood home. The area of rolling green flatlands that stretches north from the coast figures prominently in her writing. For example, in Sonnet 5, To the South Downs. Ah, hills beloved, where once a happy child, your beechen shades, your turf, your flowers among, I wove your bluebells into garlands wild, and woke your echoes with my artless song. Ah, hills beloved, your turf, your flowers remain, but can they peace to this sad breast restore? For one poor moment soothe the sense of pain, and teach a breaking heart to throb no more. This is Beachy Head, chalk cliffs on the southern coast of England. In the first two stanzas of Turner Smith's poem, Beachy Head, the speaker pictures herself reclining on the summit of the cliffs, while her fancy, her imagination, envisions the creation of England. On thy stupendous summit, rock sublime, that o'er the channel reared, halfway at sea the mariner at early morning hails, I would recline, while fancy should go forth and represent the strange and awful hour of vast concussion, when the Omnipotent stretched forth his arm and rent the solid hills, bidding the impetuous main flood rush between the rifted shores and from the continent eternally divided this green isle.
The last poem that Charlotte Turner Smith wrote, Beachy Head, was published posthumously in 1807. It exemplifies many of the characteristics that have come to define romantic poetry, including an emphasis on the natural world. Like the other romantic poets, Charlotte Turner Smith used nature not just because it's beautiful and not just for a pure love of nature, but because of romantic mysticism, because it represents the presence of a divine spirit in the world. Smith is considered an early romantic poet, perhaps even the first romantic poet, and her work does include many of the characteristics of romanticism, her use of the natural world, primitivism, and even the presence of mysticism in nature. But there are some lines in her poetry that sound very much like neoclassical poetry. For example, lines such as, "Glisten the sands with its inversion in word order, while inmates of the chalky clefts that scar thy sides precipitous with shrill, harsh cry." Thy sides precipitous, again an example of word inversion. The inmates of the chalky clefts refers to the birds that nest in the cliff sides, a personification of birds and also an example of the kind of poetic diction that Wordsworth advised against in his preface to Lyrical Ballads. Later in that same stanza, Smith uses elision in the use of or instead of the complete word over, much as Samuel Johnson, Dryden, other 18th century poets did. Also like the neoclassicals, Smith personifies attributes such as hope, fancy, luxury, memory. All of these literary devices, personification, poetic language, inversion, elision, are all typical of neoclassical poetry. However, Smith's references to the hind, meaning the rustic country dweller who makes an honest living, and her reference to the smuggler who makes a dishonest living are both examples of romantic primitivism. The interest in the lower social classes, romantic primitivism, And sensibility, the sensitivity to the emotions of the people of the lower classes, are very typical of romantic poets.